Hello, welcome to Living Science. Dr. Kanury Rao, Head of Immunology Group at the International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology in New Delhi, is here with us today. We are very happy about that. Dr. Rao has also founded a new research center, DDRC, which is part of THSTI. Dr. Rao, by training, is a chemist, now a renowned name in the field of immunology, not only in India, but internationally too.
So today we will be in conversation with Dr. Rao and try to find out his journey in life and science. Dr. Rao, very welcome.
Thank you.
So first of all, Dr. Rao, not just us and all the students everywhere want to know one big question. Are you genetically intelligent? Or you somehow plan your experiment judiciously and your projects accordingly?
Certainly not particularly intelligent. Maybe, I think, pig-headed, I guess. I mean, I think the capacity to get excited by an idea and then get obsessed by it and not give up till you've found at least some level of answer you're looking for, I think that's, at least to me, the driving force. And I know many, you know, people who are far more intelligent than me and so on. But I think this pig-headedness and perseverance till you get to at least part of where you want to go, perhaps that's one of the driving forces that,
That's a very humble answer from a person of your stature. Actually, if you look at your research, you've done a lot of very interesting work and you've done, answered a lot of basic questions in immunology and also in host pathogen interactions. So one would wonder, since you have a lot of chemistry background, you came as a chemist, did it somehow help you think differently than conventionally?
Yes, I think at least around the time when I moved into biology, chemistry was a big help. Because, you know, in chemistry, you look at structures from three-dimensional principles. You have things like stereochemistry, conformation. So understanding how proteins interact with other components like other proteins becomes relatively easier. I mean, you can conceptualize it in your mind. You can intuitively get a sense of, you know, the stereochemical interactions. So in that sense, yes, it certainly helped understand biological interactions better. And
so we wondering how did it pave your entry into understanding B cell biology?
Okay. So so my first postdoc actually was after my PhD, which was in organic chemistry, was also in synthetic chemistry. And there was a lab which also, you know, in our lab there was also some biology going on. So I got interested more in biology. Particularly there were a lot of, you know, biology was more of a conceptual area. Chemistry, at least at that time, there wasn't any great new concepts evolving and so on. So that's how I moved to biology and moved to UCLA. And there we started looking at growth factor receptors, and a completely new experience for me. So it was a learning curve in terms of understanding cells, knowing how to culture cells. All of these were completely new. But on the side, because as a chemist, I also started peptide synthesis in that lab. You know, in those days, solid phase synthesis of peptides was quite popular and had seemingly had a lot of applications. So that's something I started in my lab there, and so grew as a peptide chemist for some time. And at that time when ICGEB started and I had the opportunity to come back to ICGEB, the interface I had, because you know, it is a biology, biotechnology organization and I had no background. So the interface was, because one of the big areas at that time was peptide-based vaccines for infectious diseases. So I had, you know, I proposed that we would, you know, we could work on peptide-based vaccines for hepatitis B. And the idea at that time was, you can generate three-dimensional configurations of peptides which can mimic epitopes of the antigens of hepatitis B. So I came back and we started synthesizing peptides and looking at peptides with defined structures and so on. Of course, on the side, I had to learn immunology, so I had a lot of friends around who taught me immunology and actually what a B cell was, what an antibody was, because even those were new concepts at that time for me. And so what happened is we actually somehow got lucky. We were able to generate a peptide that spontaneously kind of folded to generate the shape of the epitope of an antigen on hepatitis B. And interestingly, and this is at this time we were collaborating with Dr. Subrat Panda at the All India Institute of Medical Science and Pathology. And he was a clinical person looking at hepatitis. And he was a wonderful collaborator, and he taught me all the clinical sides of hepatitis B. And interestingly, we found that actually this peptide not only reconstitutes the shape of the epitope, but actually assembles into virus-like particles. A completely new concept at that time, and we didn't design, we just stumbled into it. And so when we were developing this, people at CDC in Atlanta saw our papers and they got excited. And the only animal model available at that time was chimpanzee, and obviously no chimpanzees in India. So there's a guy there called Howard Fields. He wrote and said, look, we want to test it in chimpanzees. And we actually went there and tested it. And again, surprisingly, it actually worked. I mean, it prevented the chimpanzees from getting hepatitis B infection. So obviously, we were on to something interesting. Not only scientifically, in sense, you could actually reconstruct virus-like particles with a small peptide, which you could actually do electron microscopy on. And then when we came back in the next step of development, what do you do? And we went to the Director General of ICMR, and none of them had a clue what to do, because in those days, we didn't even have regulations for recombinant proteins. So peptides, I mean, was a completely, you know. So, but he said, you submit an application, we'll see. And then they lost it. Nothing happened after that. So we realized if we pursue this, we're in a dead end. What do you do? How do you make productive use of your time? So that's when we thought, okay, you know, since in this process, we learned a little about B cell responses, what antibodies are, let's start using them to study B cell responses. So that's actually how we got into looking at B cell responses, and particularly looking at how shapes define which epitopes become dominant and so on.
So some of your early work has also dealt with the finding different conformations in the receptor itself, right? How it fits into, like one receptor can recognize multiple antigens. So can you say that story?
Yeah. So actually looking at the basic, so what happened is we had this one epitope which we reconstructed, and at that time people said if you put a couple more epitopes from another antigen called a large antigen, the immunogenicity and the protective efficacy improves. So we designed a sequence which would have this conformational epitope and two other what you could call linear epitopes. And then Dr. Vijay Kumar in the virology group, he designed the gene for that. He synthesized the gene for that with spaces between epitopes. And he expressed it, and that was becoming an antigen. We started looking at responses. And interestingly, so the idea was, of course, B cells recognize the surface of protein. So any exposed region of protein was generally thought to be antigenic. And you would actually get antibodies to anything on the surface. But since we had this defined, we knew exactly the sequence and we could map the epitopes and so on, what we found actually was that as the response develops, the antibody in a mouse model, the antibody response starts getting concentrated on specific regions. So certain epitopes become more dominant than others. So that got us actually into more basic mechanisms. Why does that happen? And it turns out in literature many people had noticed this. And one of the complications in designing such vaccines. So then we started collaborating with Dr. G.C. Mishra, who was at ImTech at that time and subsequently moved as director of NCCS. And he's the one who I learned a lot of immunology from. And a lot of it was actually sitting in Kapil's bar in Chandigarh. So, and it was a fabulous exercise. So we used to sit and design crazy experiments. How do you address this problem? And the solution came out to be very fascinating. So when you have an antigen and you immunize, so the B cell receptor recognizes the antigen, and some of those B cells start producing antibodies. So you have a situation where you have antibodies against an epitope and a B cells that have to also bind the epitope, pick it up, and get T cell help to proliferate. So you actually have a competition, and if the antibody wins, the B cells die out and the epitope becomes subdominant. But if the B cells win, then you get a further amplification and selection. And it's a very fascinating mechanism that came out. So that's when we actually got in more interest in the fundamentals of B cells. And at that time, I mean, since we're chemists, we also had a lot of interest in biophysics and so on. And Dr. Manivel was one of my earliest colleagues. We have worked together for the last 25 years. And he was also a bioorganic. He was also a chemist who came into bioorganic chemistry. So we could speak the same language. We always used to wonder, because textbook tell you that B cells recognize, have the ability to recognize, you know, any epitope or any antigenic sequence, you know, that their recognition capacity is infinite. Yeah? And we know that you can take any mouse, immunize with any sequence, you create a completely new sequence, you can in principle get antibodies to that. And we used to always wonder, because so the number of B cells in the body are always restricted, right? You have a fixed number of B cells. A small fraction of those are the naive B cells, which are the ones that will recognize the antigen. So the question is, how does a small population of naive B cells have this capacity to recognize an infinite repertoire of antigens? You know, how does that happen? And while we were discussing, another interesting question came up. There is actually a theoretical paper from somebody at Scripps Institute. So the dogma again was that when an antigen goes into the body, the B cells scan, you know, it scans all the different receptors, and once the right fit is found, that B cell gets activated. And they had done calculations and they found that the scanning process actually will take a minimum of 5 weeks or so, if it has to scan 100 million or a trillion B cells. But we know the response can happen in 24 hours. So how does this process happen? And related to another question is that, look at it this way. We say that there is a clonal distribution of receptors to maximize recognition. But if I have, let's say, a bacterial infection, what has to happen? The B cell that can recognize it recognizes. It has to get activated and proliferate, make more B cells and make more antibodies. But by the time one B cell divides into two, which may take about 15 to 20 hours, the one bacteria has become millions of bacteria, because that replication time is only 20 minutes. Right? So there's no way, if you just follow simple elementary textbook logic, that B cells can protect you against an infection. So the only option nature has, the problem is you have to maximize recognition capacity and maximize response efficiency. You can't do both, unfortunately, because to maximize recognition capacity, I have to make sure if I have 100 B cells, each of them has a separate receptor capable of recognizing a different epitope. The moment I do that, I only have one copy of receptor per, you know, one B cell per antigen. So by the time that becomes many, a long time is taken. If I want to improve response efficiency, the other way I make sure, okay, 10 of the B cells have one particular type of receptor, so that they recognize the bacteria. So 10 B cells responding, response is cut short. But in that process, I'm diminishing my recognition capacity. But obviously, we are alive today, we have survived evolution, and that was like a huge intellectual problem. How does it, the problem of maximizing repertoire, at the same time ensuring maximum response efficiency, and with a minimal response time. We started thinking about that, and actually then we started, you know, then we started exploring that problem. And we generated antibodies from the very early stage of a response, 2 days after an immunization, against different antigens. And so the antibodies that you get in the very early stage are actually surrogate receptors in a sense, because the binding site is the same. There's no mutations and so on. And we took those as surrogates for the B cell receptor to look at now how do they recognize antigen. And then we use a phage display library. So now you have, that is a 6 mer sequences, so you have 6 raised to 20 different antigenic sequences. So in a sense, you're simulating the real life situation. You have a small panel of receptors, let's say, and exposed to a large unlimited panel of antigens. How many do they recognize? And what we found surprisingly was each of them actually doesn't recognize one, but recognize hundreds of those sequences. And they're completely unrelated. No chemical homology, no structural homology, and so on. And then we started looking at the mechanism of binding. How do you do that? And the way how do I know, understand the binding process, or in a sense, the recognition process? And that's when we went back to 8th or 9th standard thermodynamics. Because remember, when you talk about a protein binding to something, it involves charge and shape complementarity. So how do these two parameters fit in a binding reaction? Now, so how do I study these two without going to crystal structure and so on? So we use this Gibbs free energy equation, you know, free energy delta H minus T delta S, where the S is the entropy component, so degree of disorder. H is the enthalpy. So in a sense, enthalpy represents the strength of the interactions between these two surfaces. And entropy represents any readjustments that happen, change in order of the structure. And we found that in one of these, any of the antibody can recognize 100 sequences all with the same affinity, and the affinity of micromolar, which is the affinity of an early immune response. And they do that because everything involved an entropic penalty. So, suggesting that the antibody is actually plastic and can adapt to bind different shapes or of different surfaces of antigens. And okay, now what I say, when I say plastic, it means flexibility of the CDR loops. So, and in one shot that solved the entire puzzle, because I now have flexible shapes so that any given antibody, so if I have 100 molecules of that particular, so let us say B cell has 100,000 receptors, copies of that particular receptor, each of them exists in different flexible conformations. It's like a, you know, like a rubber band, if you stretch it and tap it, it exists in multiple conformations. So that when a particular antigen comes, you can trap it in any one conformation. And since it's, there is no energy involved, there is no energetic penalty to that binding. And because of that flexibility, any one of these early antibodies can bind hundreds of antigens. Conversely, hundreds of antibodies can bind any one antigen. So, and that one simple solution solved the whole puzzle, because now each B cell can bind many different antigens and get activated. Conversely, many different B cells can bind the same antigen. So that's how, and because many B cells can bind the same antigen, the recognition time business problem goes. And because of the diverse repertoire, the amplified recognition capacity puzzle is solved. And because multiple B cells recognize, you get a very rapid response, and large numbers of B cells are activated. So which is why your early IgM response is very high, and it at least serves to dampen an infection. So one simple solution to this complex, almost impossible problem, and nature has done it so beautifully. I mean, that was really wonderful to see, to get the solution. You know, when you see the beauty of something like this, a simple but elegant mechanism, it's really a wonderful, you understand how elegantly evolution has worked to design these systems. So that was really a first into this recognition problem and how these issues are sorted out.
That's actually a fascinating work. So, how did you went from BCR understanding, how BCR works, to more like activation, maturation, differentiation of these antigen specific B cells, more complex and more biology, if you will?
So, again, a lot of our interest has been how biological systems make decisions, and in many senses that's the abiding interest even today, although dimensions and the ways you approach it has changed. So what happens, okay, so to start with, I get a large number of B cells activated in a response, making lots of different antibodies. They're all low affinity, micromolar, so they control the infection. What we know is that from that, a small pool of them get selected, go into these structures called germinal centers, and go through mutational improvements, and within 2 to 3 weeks, you start seeing very high affinity antibodies, right? So the question we asked is, how does that happen? So first I had a postdoc who looked at what is the criteria for this selection. When I get these, let's say 1,000 B cells activated, only 2 or 3 of them will be selected for maturation. They become the memory pool also. And what she discovered or found was they're selected on the basis of affinity. I'm just using affinity for want of a better at this point. So that out of the 1,000 B cells, the 2 or 3 of the best affinity are what are selected. So then by then I had another PhD student come, Akansha, and she was a wonderful, I mean, now currently she's a faculty at ICER Pune, but she was also as argumentative as I was, and we used to sit in the corridor with coffee and argue for hours, and it was an exhilarating experience. Because we used to puzzle over how is the selection take place? How does the system know which B cells need to be selected and so on? So she designed a system where, and by then we had actually developed a protocol for reconstituting germinal centers in mice. And again, this is all jugad and tukka and all kinds of things. I don't know how to say it, because we've never done this thing before. So you can irradiate mice with the follicular dendritic cell there, and you can reconstitute the antibody you want, the immune complex you want, and the B cells you want, and see exactly what selection events happen. And she also developed a system where you can purify these IgD positive cells. These are the early B cells, which have IgD receptor. And you can activate them at different affinity and see what the outcome is. So you can transfer it back into a mouse and see now does it become a memory cell or not. And then she, once that was standard, she developed a shorter system of measures by looking at cell markers. So we knew that if you only activate a calcium response, you get a cell that had decided just to make primary antibodies and die out. That's what happens to 998 or 1000 B cells that are activated. But if you activate the calcium plus a cyclic AMP response, you actually get cells that are decided to become memory B cells. Now the question, how does this happen? And when she was studying this, she discovered, because normally the IgD receptors are transmembrane receptors and they only activate the calcium response and not the cyclic AMP response. But what she discovered was there was another subset of IgD receptors which are GPI anchored. So they are not transmembrane, but they are sticking to the surface through a lipid anchor. And those are the guys which activate the cyclic AMP response. But that still didn't solve the problem of how. So the thing is, if an antigen binds to these receptors and only triggers calcium, the B cell has decided to make antibodies and die out. If it binds in such a way that activates both, then it becomes a memory B cell and matures and becomes a memory B cell. But just identifying these two receptors didn't really help us in any way. But when she quantified how many of these receptors there, she found that the transmembrane, the conventional receptor, almost 97% to 98% of these IgD receptors. And the ones in the GPI anchor are very small, only about 2% to 3%, you know. And the moment we got those numbers, we knew we had cracked the problem. Because both of these receptors have to be triggered. So now, let's say I have this B cell as IgD receptor and a low affinity antigen binds. When it binds, since it's low affinity, only some partial some of the receptors are occupied by antigen. And since the transmembrane dominant, majority of them are the transmembrane receptors. So you only get one pathway activated. When I have a high affinity, I'm saturating the receptor, so both subsets get occupied and both pathways are triggered, and that's where the decision making. And that's another beautiful principle in terms of evolution of these systems, because it works only when you have the 97.3% distribution. If you had a 50-50, it won't work. It cannot select affinity. If you have even, you know, 90-10, it can still select affinity, but the threshold will be, you know, lower. So 97 gives you exquisite sensitivity to look at only the highest affinity, which will saturate, you know, within short time frames, and only those get selected. And that was another, you know, beautiful insight into the elegance. And that's how intelligent decision making. In fact, that's how we concluded our paper, saying that, you know, you get an insight into intelligent decision making. How intelligence comes in, because it's very critical. If all the 1000 B cells were to go for maturation, the system would collapse and you would die. You have to select the best so that you can quickly optimize it in one or two rounds of mutation and give good, you know. So that's very critical to our survival. And this selection, this distribution of two isoforms of the same receptor in unequal form allows that, you know, degree of intelligence. You know, and so that was another beautiful, you know, insight into something very simple but very elegant. You know.
So Dr. Rao, you are answering some very delicate and very interesting intricate questions. So how did you went about wondering how the transcription regulated in post-immunity molecules? Because some of your work also kind of touched on that.
Yeah. So actually, you know, when you work in immunology, even particularly lymphocytes, one of the things that strikes you is that the same cells respond in so many different ways depending on how the receptor is triggered, right? Depending on, let's say, the way receptor is triggered, the cell can proliferate or differentiate or energize, die, and so on. So it's actually a challenging question, is how do different decisions emanate from the same receptor? So it becomes, you start thinking of it in terms of communication, because what the receptors are doing is communicating information about the antigen to the nucleus, so that the nucleus can then drive an appropriate response through a gene expression program. So at that time we started looking at receptor-mediated signaling, and the other end was how are those signals then transferred to drive a gene expression program. So we had, at that time, there were four students in the lab. Two were looking at the signaling, two were looking at transcription. And the idea was somewhere the twain will meet. So in terms of signaling, one of the questions is, okay, how does the communication process change depending on the nature of antigen? How, what happens, you know, what are the changes in signals as a function of the difference in nature of antigen? So at that time then, you know, we had a student was working, Dinesh. So he was actually looking at particularly the receptor proximal signal, you know. And he made a very interesting discovery, is that, maybe I'll just step back. There's a big controversy on how a signaling pathway is activated, particularly in those days. Is it that, so when you know, when you talk about signaling pathway, you're largely talking about kinases and phosphatase, right? Phosphorylation reactions. And you also need dephosphorylation reactions, so to bring them back into the cycle. So one of the debates was, how is signaling activated? So is it that a particular kinase is activated so that the phosphorylation cascade starts? Or is it that the kinases are largely active and it's the active phosphatases that keep things in check? So you have to inactivate the phosphatase and allow this kinase signaling. So I can initiate a signaling cascade by inactivating a phosphatase. And in our case, at least B cell, that's what Dinesh found, is exactly that's what happened, particularly at the receptor proximal area. So what he found actually is that when you trigger the receptor, this reactive oxygen species that is immediately released, and what that does is inactivate a phosphatase associated with the receptor, because phosphatases are sensitive to reactive oxygen, because in their active site they have a cysteine, which can then be oxidized by reactive oxygen to give you sulfenic acid, so it becomes inactive, but that's a reversible process. Okay, I'll just come back to that in a minute. So the hydrogen peroxide then inactivates the phosphatase, and that kicks off the signal. And what happens is that that then first activates a calcium response, and you set up a feedback loop between calcium and reactive oxygen that keeps driving the signals. And that feedback loop functions like what we call a monostable system. And what I mean by monostable system is like the rheostat there. Basically, in terms of controls in biological circuits, you have two broad types of controls. One is called bistable, which is switching on and off. It's exactly like the board there. You have a switch which you can switch on and off. That's a bistable system. Or a monostable system that can function like a rheostat. And what we discovered is that this feedback loop functions like a rheostat. And the intensity is actually controlled by the phosphatase. And that turns out very interesting, because like I said, phosphatase inactivation is reversible. So depending on the initial oxygen kick, reactive oxygen kick, you get a pulsed inactivation of phosphatase. And that amplitude of that pulse can vary depending on the oxygen. So that I can get a short pulse of phosphatase inactivation or a bigger pulse of phosphatase. And depending on that, that defines the strength of the signal that is generated. And the strength of the signal then defines how far it goes. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, how loud I shout will also determine the distance to which the signal travels. And I'm putting distance very crudely, because actually it means something else. Or maybe I can just come. And in subsequent study, with what Dheeraj was, another student, was focusing on, is what do we mean by all this? And he looked very exhaustively at different components of the signaling, you know, molecules, and looked at them in great detail. If you perturb each one, how does the sensitivity of each of these vary? And again, there we were forced to come up with new methods for measurement, because you can measure phosphorylation profiles, but if I want to convert them into quantitative thing, how do I quantify a phosphorylation profile? And we struggled, and then we realized each one is like a triangle. So you can take, you know, this is the time it takes to maximum profile, so you can take half the time taken for maximal. You can take the peak value and the slope of the dephosphorylation, and if you integrate those three, you have a number now, and it's a unique number that defines the phosphorylation curve. That we did. So now you have numbers for different proteins, signaling proteins, under different conditions, and that number can vary. Let's say AKT, if I take as one molecule, under different receptor perturbation conditions, that number profile will obviously change. So the numbers will change. So now if I want to quantify how perturbable or how sensitive it is to influence, how do I quantify the distribution of numbers? So again, I mean, these are things, again, like exactly what it is, all jugaad. So then we realized, okay, there is something called the traveling salesman problem in mathematics, which is if I am a salesman sitting in Delhi and I have to now go on a, you know, to sell my product, I have to go to Bombay, then Chennai, then Trivandrum, then Shimla, then Srinagar. What is the shortest route I can follow to cover all of these points? And once you determine that, you can actually measure the distance you have traveled. And we did exactly that. So depending on how perturbable it is, you put it in a three-dimensional rock and measure the shortest distance that they can cover through these trajectories. And you can actually now define how sensitive each of these signaling molecules are to differences in perturbation of the receptor. And then you realize the network functions like a kaleidoscope. It functions like a kaleidoscope because it's like every time you shake it a bit, the patterns are different. And it's the patterns that are read by the nucleus. So different patterns being read differently by the nucleus is, we know what signaling molecules do is activate transcription factors. And what transcription factors do is trigger, obviously, transcription. But key to that is, so to trigger expression of a gene, I need certain transcription factors to kind and bind the promoter and the enhancer elements, right? But it's not just the transcription factors coming and binding. They have to come in a particular order. So if I need let's say transcription factor A, B, and C, for a particular gene, I may first need A to come and bind. A will then recruit B as a co-complex, and then C. If I reverse the order or change the order, I will not get that enhanceosome complex assembled on the promoter. And that's what patterns are dictating. Which transcription factors, what is the timing of activation and so on. And that's where specificity in gene expression lies. And that's why a handful of transcription factors, 400, 300, whatever, can differentially regulate expression of almost the 30, 40,000 genes and differently under different contexts. And we forget that complexity today. We say NF-kappa-B does this. It does nothing on its own. And NF-kappa-B can't do everything. Because remember, you can do a simple experiment. You do a microarray analysis. You treat the cell, you know, maybe even 20 degrees, 25, 30, and look at it. It will change dramatically. Anything will change. And no two of them will give you exactly the same gene expression profile. So there's very exquisite differentiation. And that's done by not just the transcription factors, by the order in which they bind and they assemble in the on the promoter to trigger the transcriptional event. So the language actually is in patterns defining the order and kinetics of transcription. So that's how we could begin to understand the communication process. And then, as a test case, we took one of these co-stimulatory molecule promoters, which had two start sites. We wanted to see how it responds to different signals. And in that process, we discovered an interesting new way by which transcription can also be regulated. So at one of the start sites, it turns out, so that is again mega exercise which we started knowing nothing about, started by mapping the nucleosomes around that whole region. It turned out that the promoter region is completely nucleosome free, very unusual. And the earliest nucleosome was about 600 base pairs upstream of the start site. And the promoter had no core promoter element for POL2 recruitment, none of the known. So we couldn't figure out how it is regulated. And we had to learn how to do chromatin immunoprecipitation. At that time, nobody in the country was doing chromatin immunoprecipitation. And, you know, so you sit and read and make your own mistakes and blunder and so on. And finally, you know, well, this is a student called Anuja, and tremendous spirit. Actually, it's mostly a lot of the students who have had the guts and courage and perseverance to carry through. Because there's no way I could tell them what to do. You know, they come and say, sir, it's not working. What do? I say, I don't know. Right? Anyway, but but finally what she discovered is a fabulous mechanism, because the problem is there's no core promoter element in that. So where is the POL, how is the POL2 positioning? So it turns out that the nucleosome 600 base pair upstream has half the sequence for NF-kappa-B. And that, so when you trigger the nucleosome unwind, the DNA unwind on the nucleosome, and that's again we could do it by learning all those methodologies. And then the NF-kappa-G come and bind because there's another HMG box protein sitting there. So So NF kappa we can bind to half the consensus sequence because the other protein is helping it, and the pol, then it recruits the pol 2 and then the DNA bends back. So we had to do all those three chromosome conformation capture assays and bends back and positions the polymerase on the start, pol 2 on the start site, and that is how transcription gets kicked off. And the other promoter, the other start site actually had a the pol 2 had already started processing, moved 200 base pair downstream and got stalled there, and a different signal is required to release that. So now you get a sense of how, why by these two start sites they become responsive to different kinds of signals to trigger transcription of the same protein. You know, so that is how it is translated also, not just enantiosome but by differentially utilizing start sites and so on. So that is how we could actually understand, I think, one step more in this communication process. So that was